has long been known that London is a magnet for Russian dissidents and billionaires.
London is the greatest city in the world, and it's so close to Moscow. It's easier for a lot of Russian oligarchs or for Russian businessmen to meet in London just before a Chelsea match or Wimbledon than somewhere in Moscow, in Krasnodar or in St. Petersburg.
But what if you were invited into their lives?
They're coming.
To understand why over 100,000 Russians now call London home.
I'm devoted, I'm in love with London forever. I don't know, maybe there is some English person living inside me, but I'm still quite Russian too.
The new Russians, as we're called, began arriving in London in the late 90s, adding to the mix of political emigres and descendants of Russian aristocracy.
This is Irina, who is my father's elder sister. Irina married a man called Felix Yusupov. Now, Felix was one of the two that murdered Rasputin.
But what attracts Russia's rich to London? And what does money really mean to those of us who can no longer count how much we have?
These guys who are worth, let's say, 100 million, they say we are not wealthy because there are guys who are worth a billion. So those guys who are worth a billion said we are not wealthy, there are tens of billions. So it's all about perception.
Several billion pounds a year are estimated to flow into the British economy from Russia. And many Russians have come to London to support the needs of our country's super rich. You can give it to
our birds and bees. I used to sort of steal it from my dad and go driving.
Roman Grigoryev is one of them.
It's really emotional for a lot of our clients, and everyone recognizes it. It's an iconic, very iconic, yeah. Ooh. Yep, does happen.
Roman and his business partner Dmitry Zakirov use their vintage Volga to publicize the company they set up.
So we're our company called Longrad, and we help predominantly Russian-speaking clients find residential, commercial, investment properties in London. So initially it started mostly for Russians buying flats and houses in prime central London. Then they branched out more into the countryside, bought bigger estates. Especially in the last 2 years, the number of clients increased dramatically, partially probably due to sanctions and the economic recession that's taking place in Russia. So clients are looking to take, not just to take money and safeguard their capital, but actually earn some additional revenues here in London. And I think 20% of all properties above 5 million have been bought by Russian-speaking and Russian clients in prime central London. I need money.
Yeah, so since this car does not have sat-nav, we developed the map of London, which have all points of interest for Russians. So it's key hotels, it's One Hyde Park, there's key shopping places, such as Harrods, so we can show them properties around it. Or the Russian embassy, so everyone knows where the Russian embassy is. Again, this is the Billionaire Row with the Kensington Palace.
According to the recent statistic, every buyer who buys the flat around 10 million pound mark spends around 4.5 million a year. So that brings a new economy, which is good.
Really, Russian money is helping London economy. It's partially squeezing out many of us, out of Knightsbridge and Mayfair, but realistically, would you ever be there? Probably not. Mayfair, strangest in the afternoon. Mayfair stretching far above, full of fame but lacking love. Mayfair is a proper, truly epicenter of London property. Yeah, and if you go just straight there, you've got Chichvarkin's shop. You probably met Evgeny Chichvarkin. In the day,
in the dark. Evgeny Chichvarkin owns Hedonism, a luxury wine retailer in the heart of Mayfair. He made his fortune as a mobile phone tycoon in post-communist Russia. But he had to flee Russia in 2008 and sell his company. His wealth is estimated in the hundreds of millions.
My name is Evgeny Chichvarkin. I'm founder and investor in the best wine shop in the world. we changed fine wine retail market completely in London. Every well-known shop with a fine and rare wines, the first they changed design and they changed service and they changed assortment as well.
Yevgeny started Hedonism because he felt that the finest wines were not readily available in London. But trading of some sort is in his blood.
I'm buying and selling something from my 16 years old. When I started to selling something, it was illegal, it was Soviet Union. I spent four years on the open markets without roof on my head. Winter, minus 20. I have frozen toes. But still positive wave of every customer.
Everything changed for Yevgeny with the fall of the Soviet Union. He was just 17.
Soviet Union crashed in 1992 and a lot of people, let's say 90% of the people, had the proper Soviet minds. And it was easy to make money. We started selling mobile phones when the penetration of mobile phones was less than 1%. And we just caught the wave. We started from one shop, one very small shop, like a corner shop. And then opened another one, and then another one. I just wanted money.
Yevgeny started his business aged 22, and it grew so fast that he didn't even realize he had become a millionaire.
Our accounting manager said us when we reached 2 million. I don't remember the years because it was kind of nightmare. 24/7 non-stop, buying and selling.
Yevgeny isn't the only Russian in London who found the secret of success at a young age. Katya Elizarova is now an international supermodel. Her career began in Russia when she was just 14, though she now calls London her home.
I was scouted by a girl from Moscow, and she just walked to me on my way from school and asked me if I want to be a model. And I knew nothing about modeling at that time. I'm brought up by my grandmother, where I have to, you know, think of my future, think of my work in the office or in a factory, I don't know, whatever would suit me. Certainly not modeling, certainly not traveling. So she came over to me and she asked me if I want to be on the cover of a magazine. Like, really? They don't even regard me pretty in my school. They think I'm too thin and too tall and I look like Pinocchio. You wanted to talk to me. And he said, yeah, apparently that's what they like there in Europe.
Last year, Katya opened Moscow Fashion Week.
I was just noticed on the streets of my native town, taken out of the obscurity, traveled the world, and you can get up to $50,000 for like a month's stay. Balthazar. I loved England from the very beginning. I loved English language. My dad was obsessed with the Western culture. We always listened to English music, and it was prohibited as well at some point. So when eventually I was offered to go to England, well, I was over the moon.
Katya is not just a pretty face. In her early teens, she trained as a dancer at the Bolshoi Ballet.
It's really cold.
Yeah.
And in London, she studied law before turning to modeling full time.
You can fall in love with London every day, can't you? There's always something new there, and all the buildings are different from what my eye is accustomed to. And there are roses growing. There are no tall you know, like gates or like walls, because in Russia, you if you live in a house, you always have like really tall walls to protect yourself, your to, so people don't see your walls. But in England, no one cares. In England, everyone destroyed these walls, and the walls are made of roses. Isn't that fantastic? I'm devoted. I'm in love with London forever. London calling to the faraway towns. Now war is declared and battle come down.
London calling to the underworld. Come out of the cupboard. While Yevgeny and Katya have undoubtedly worked hard for their wealth, people remain suspicious that some of the money of London's rich Russians is not quite as honestly hard earned. But Roman feels blanket accusations are unfair.
Everyone thinks about Russian money in London as this crazy, as Dmitry rightly said, crazy money that's from oil and gas, that sort of connections to the government. But Russia is a huge country of 140 million, and we're talking at Ukraine and everything else. Not everyone is connected to the government. There are huge retail chains where billionaires are made. There are huge internet portals. There are huge restaurant chains, everything. And so there are loads and loads of properly clean businessmen who have no connections to the government.
One rich Russian who amassed his wealth in high finance now invests in art and has a personal collection of post-war Russian art estimated to be worth over 40 million pounds. So what does money mean to Igor Tsukhanov?
The first money you earn after business, whatever, you put residential. Then maybe second home, okay. Then maybe to stay in five-star hotels on to fly first business class. So, but what else? After these few simple things, which basically save your time, and for example, in the queues, in the flights, whatever, it's like basically saving your time. So after that, you should have imagination how to spend money for yourself. So therefore, I would say in this level, yes, I think guys start looking, okay, what if I don't mind myself? Okay, I can make, what I can do? So and this, does bring them to the charity, because in the charity it's unlimited.
Igor Tsukhanov's family charity gives educational scholarships and promotes Russian culture and art around the world. Tonight, Igor has brought an exhibition of world art to the Sarchi Gallery.
I started doing my art activity, a kind of art promotion in the global art scene. A major exhibitions, including the one post-pop East meets West.
Igor has collected much of his art at auction. One auction house he knows well is run by William and Catherine McDougall. They specialize in Russian art and handle around a quarter of the global market. 120 I will take. Their story is a classic tale of Russian-English connection that goes back generations.
Our families knew each other. But William's grandfather left after the revolution. Mine stayed in Russia. But the families kept pre-revolutionary summer houses. So I grew up with William's cousin. So when William went to Moscow to look for his relatives and actually meet them, so that's how we met.
I always knew that I had the Russian heritage, was always very excited by and intrigued by the by my Russian grandfather. So yes, I always knew it, and I suppose you could say the great adventure of my life was rediscovering the Russian connection.
100,000 to start.
We have two big dates, twice a year, two auctions, so we work for 6 months and we never know what will happen on the day, so fate is always decided within a few hours.
Over the years, Igor Tsukhanov has spent a great deal of money here.
It's like a theater and, you know, gambling at the same time. And it's all big money, so people get very, very excited.
At 210, so 210, 220, 230, 230, 240, 250, 250, 260, 270.
Rubbing shoulders with collectors who spend millions,
Catherine has gained particular insight into how great wealth affects character.
Money is basically energy. And a lot of money is a lot of energy. And not every person can handle a lot of money. So I think that, you know, if we're talking, you know, a couple of million is sort of wealth, is kind of still not something that changes your personality. But if you go, you know, into big figures, if you go, you know, into hundreds of million, closer to a billion, then it's a different, absolutely different energy.
950 then. You all done? And 901 million. I now have the 1 million in the middle of the room at 1 million. And I'll take 1.1 million. On my run, 1.1 million. 1.15, I think. 1.2, sir. 1.2 million bid. 1.2 million. More. Okay. All done. Sarah, thank you very much indeed.
What is the actual definition of wealth? These guys who are worth, let's say, 100 million, they say we are not wealthy because there are guys who are worth a billion. So those guys who are worth a billion said we are not wealthy, there are tens of billions. So it's just completely different. It's all about perception. Because anything above whatever, 50 million or 60 or 100 million, it's much. So it's really nothing about the numbers. So numbers means nothing. To be a wealthy man is a man who can afford to spend lots of money on charity. This for me, that's what the definition I like. So the rest is not important. Because the cost for living, it's pretty kind of minimal for anyone. It doesn't matter.
For Igor, his love of both art and philanthropy have become one.
I say it's not only hobby anymore. It's not profession, but it's a kind of art support from a philanthropic point of view. If you look carefully, you see a face in Sign of Lights. And he said to me, when we're painting the stuff, there was no idea to put the face over there. I'm not sure I trust fully what he's saying, because it's clear the face over there, it's clear. But he didn't admit that it was intentional, it was unintentional, I think.
Igor's deep passion for Russian art reflects a connection many of us feel with Russian culture, even if we are choosing to live in London.
Welcome. We're very excited to have you with us, and hopefully you enjoy the journey. The journey starts today and never finishes. So we'll go.
One way we keep connected to the homeland is through the annual Russian Ball, one of the highlights of the social calendar for London's Russians. The ball echoes back to pre-communist Russia, when debutantes were presented at the court of the Tsar, hoping to make an impression with their faultless footwork.
Very big step, smaller. One, two, three. Yep. One, no, it's the left leg. We'll go with the right.
The pressure to impress and be noticed on the night is fierce. And for a modern generation of Russians more familiar with twerking than Tchaikovsky, special rehearsals are essential.
One, two, three. Two, three. One, two, three. One, two, three. One, two, three.
When I first heard about the ball, I was slightly skeptical, because I couldn't imagine myself wearing a white dress, wearing a tiara, and dancing waltz.
Tatiana is one of the debutantes. She moved to London 3 years ago, leaving her parents behind in Moscow to pursue a career in music.
I am a very traditional girl in a way, because I play the cello. And this is a very, you know, doing classical music also is a very traditional thing. My dad is a self-made man. We lived in one room in the communal flat in Moscow, and that's how it started. I never took it for granted. Coming from a wealthy family gives me this opportunity to really explore the music world without having to worry about earning my living from day to day. There is much more to being a musician than just making music for fun. If you experience this moment of connection with something greater within yourself, that's the moment when you want to have more of that.
Tatiana and the rest of the debutantes have just 3 weeks to find a connection with the dances that will open the Russian Ball. But some are finding it more challenging than others. While events like the Russian Ball help us to stay in touch with Russian culture, adjusting to British culture is sometimes a challenge. But help is at hand, in the form of Russian lifestyle consultants.
My name is Aliona Muchinska, and I came to your lovely country many, many, many years ago. I became a lifestyle consultant, the bridge between Russia and Britain.
Aliona does everything from finding schools to buying diamond rings. She is available 24/7.
Алло. Да, привет, алло. Нет. Wealthy Russian people are my job. When they come here or when they're just thinking about coming here, it is my job and my duty to make sure that they feel at home.
Hello, this is Aliona.
Russians who come here, they like living comfortably. They would not economize. They would like to invest in something that they feel that there is a value in it. So, you know, to have a flat in London, it is, there is a value. To have a child in a prestige English school, it is value. They feel that they're investing in the future.
No, I understand.
But Aliona finds it is often the small things that make us stand out in British society.
British people think that Russians are reserved and sometimes very rude because Russians don't smile. And for British people, it's completely unheard of. They really feel offended because they smile and I just think that in Russia, if you smile at the stranger, I mean, unless obviously it's a very pretty young girl, you know, people just think that you are really quite strange. You know, you probably better not even look at this person anymore because there's something wrong with him, perhaps, most likely.
Two of Aliona's clients, mother and daughter, Natalia and Christina Muller, have been in London 2 years now, but still find the cultural differences a challenge.
Can I speak, please?
Of course.
Okay, my name is Christina and my mom's name is Natalia. And we're both really close and we're both like friends because I have secrets and I don't have any secrets from my mom because I tell it to her all the time. So there is nothing I hide from her.
For 1 year, you know, I just explored London, explored British people and not British because a lot of internationality, yeah, live here. British people, Brits, they are very open when you first see them, you know. They every time smile and they very polite. And do you agree with me?
Yeah, I do. But sometimes they're thinking bad things inside, but I don't think that my mom's friends think bad about her inside because they invite my mom everywhere.
Yeah, but when you want, for example, in Russia, when we like somebody, like to be, like personality and want to be
like
closer, we want to be closer with this person.
Can actually feel it and see it.
Yeah, but when you try to be close or closer?
Closer.
Closer with Brits, it's impossible because there is a like wall.
Between
and
them.
You just can't understand. They are so nice people. What's wrong? Maybe was something wrong with me? Maybe I'm just like...
No, I know. It's like with my friends as well. They don't let to go inside. They don't share everything that they have, the thoughts.
You know, people have different cultural things, you know. Some of nationalities don't like being touched, you know. And Russians would kiss you 3 times. And, you know, an English person who is kind of, you know, he just... And then just think, oh my God. And especially men. And you just think, hold on a second, you know, I don't know you.
The mullahs, like many wealthy Russians, have a second home in London. They can commute to and from Moscow just 4 hours flight away, whilst the families live here. It is safe and cultured. There are plenty of Russians, and of course there is excellent shopping.
Это малыш. Спасибо.
Вот я сказала, что мы купили наш диван у тебя в магазине.
So, I've prepared some nice concept for your bedroom.
Natalia and Kristina are in the process of renovating their flat in central London.
And then all the other chairs you have without. That big. It's quite big.
And you can like make it smaller when you put this in.
Yeah, for
it's
sure.
London thing.
London thing? Why?
We don't have it in Russia.
In this... Oh, come on, Kristina.
So what's your favorite
piece? Anna Davidson is a Russian businesswoman who has set up a successful design brand in London, catering to wealthy clients. She feels you should take a closer look at why Russians enjoy ostentatious displays of wealth before you make judgments.
Because everything was forbidden and it was not allowed, when the Russian did get the opportunity, they wanted to express themselves and they wanted to show, I have so much and I have that and I want everyone to see it. So before we judge someone, we should look deeper behind it. What's the reason? What's the reason the Russians are so overdressed all the time and put so much jewelry and wear all these expensive bags and shoes? Because their parents never had this. They were not allowed to have these things. And today, they have the money. They can afford it. So they want to show it to the whole world. Here we are.
When Russians started coming, they were coming, like, you know, buying stuff in Harrods, and all men were wearing these thick golden chains around their necks, and they all looked like mafia. And their perception of beauty was this big gold chain, because they never seen this gold chain before. So they kind of felt it was very beautiful, and kind of they wore it with pride.
A kiss on the hand may be quite continental, but diamonds are a girl's best friend.
Alena often helps her clients with their shopping. Today, she is meeting a specialist who provides many of London's super rich with their more striking pieces of jewelry. Her client wishes to remain anonymous.
As girls grow old and we all
when you have two diamonds of the same category, they'll be completely different because diamonds are unique, just like fingerprints or snowflakes.
These rocks.
Right now, I just don't buy it. That's it. Why do I need a reason to spend £5 million? Okay, well. I think, you know, it began, you know, probably 2.5-3 years ago when we started doing a lot of things with celebrities. I haven't lived in Hollywood before. I have connection with a few celebrities, and then I've done. Well, I've given them jewellery, lend jewellery, and they've bought a few things from me, and then through word of mouth. It's a diamond egg, has over 1,000 diamonds of the finest quality. It's a unique masterpiece, there's never going to be one replicated, and the estimated value is between £5 to £10 million.
There may come a time when...
There was just a couple of new rings that came, you know, this one especially has one of the biggest Burmese sapphires in the world right now. This is a 60 carat Burmese sapphire and surrounded by diamonds. As I know, you know, she likes a big kind of cocktail,
yeah,
right?
And
ring, something like that, you know? That may be something that she's gonna be. It's very heavy. It's very, very heavy.
Yeah.
At least we can do it for her for £1 million.
Yeah, I think she's looking to spend around. I mean, last time it was a couple of
months. Yeah, just under 1.9, yeah. Just under 2 million.
The jewels purchased by the lady who is happy to pay £1 million for a ring will be worn on the night of the Russian ball. Now, just a few days away.
Cha? No, you're not doing, you're just looking. Should not be movement, I see it with my back.
So, ladies, Katerina Daminova works at an international bank by day and practices her dancing by night. She is a fiercely independent woman, but is also pragmatic about the opportunities the ball may offer.
It might be a very, very good opportunity to meet some good gentlemen, and for some gentlemen to meet some beautiful ladies. I took the preparations for the ball really, really seriously because I really wanted to polish up my dancing technique. So I took some extra lessons.
New York. Cha-cha, one, two, three.
It was actually difficult to find a dance partner because I'm really tall. So I had to borrow my friend's boyfriend to do this for me. I would never call myself anything like money elite. I would prefer to represent cultural elite, intelligentsia, people who have used the money as a wise investment into their education.
Start with our right foot, and it's one, two, three, clap, backwards, two, three, clap. So, and. One, two, three, clap. Backwards, two, three, clap.
The debutants have still some way to go if their dancing is to earn them a place among the cultural elite.
Well, it doesn't sound like you impressed them very much, being honest. With regards to gentlemen, a responsibility is on your shoulders. No pressure. I see you've all got potential and you're like picked up a lot like from the first class, but you need to speed up because we have only 3 classes to go. It's really nothing.
Like many of the debutants, Katya was born into what was then the Soviet Union.
Sit? That is not sit, this is down.
Going to university in England helped her to understand some of the differences between our countries and put them in a historical perspective.
I studied law, and reading law was also sort of learning about England and understanding why law is so important in England and how it is never going to have as much appeal in Russia. I guess Russians have been abused quite a lot by our politicians. And it's a huge country. I mean, how can you even rule a country like that? And Russians have a mind of their own. Not that our English don't, but English believe in a higher order that in justice, because maybe justice is done, maybe because you witness justice, but it doesn't happen that often in my country. So people lose their ability to think that anything good ever comes from the government. Well, I say no law, no justice. It's getting better. I hope it does. But we are still in the progress of creating it. We've been thrown out of developing pretty much during Second World War. I mean, 20 million men died. And before that, First World War. And then we also have an amazing guy called Stalin who decided that despite that 20 million are dead, let's kill some more. Just to teach a lesson. So was Lenin, because it was cleansing during Lenin's time as well. Not many people in Europe know about it, but in Russia we know. So many of us died. There was no time to develop and think of justice and create this idea like you English people managed to do it.
Obviously, Russians coming here for financial reasons, for security, for safety, for being sure that, you know, that tomorrow nothing will change and, you know, kind of the regime or the kind of situation won't change. So, you know, your business will not be taken from you.
When you open 20 meters corner shop, you don't need to be Putin's friend. And when you open the next one and the next one and the next one, you don't need to be Putin's friend.
But once Yevgeny had grown a hugely successful business, the government did take an interest and he was placed under investigation.
When one of the Putin chosen person tried to take my business and take my money, I was need to sell it and move outside my country. Here I'm a guest and I will be, if I will live here 20 years, I will still will be the guest. I'm not at home. It's comfortable life, it's interesting, comfortable life. It's a beautiful, beautiful city. Interesting people, interesting business. But my home is Moscow. If I was close to government, I promise you, the London never have this so beautiful shop.
Like a magnet for money, isn't it? People are just coming to London, they're trying to impress themselves, and they try to impress people around them. I mean, walk around Harrods, the cars you see there.
A Mercedes covered in a million Swarovski crystals, and it belongs to a Russian. But 21-year-old Daria Rodionova auctioned her car off for charity. It sold for almost 155,000. And she donated part of the profits to a Manchester dog's home.
No, I think Swarovski won fine. I mean, it's not so much of a trouble, but have you seen this car that is covered in, what is it, velvet? Imagine this, you know, this seagull coming from Brighton. Things like, ooh, what is it here? It's like how expensive your dry cleaning bill should be.
We were kept in, like a lot of people say, an aquarium, where we were kind of swimming with other fish, but you know, we couldn't get out. And when people started getting out, they started learning. They learned about the world, they learned about fashion, about travel, etc., etc. So the perception of what to do with wealth, how to spend it, definitely did change.
Yevgeny Chichvarkin has been attracted to a sport associated with the British upper classes. For him, it is the ultimate relaxation.
Now I have capital, I can do what I really want to do. Money gives you kind of freedom for some things. When I'm on the horse, I forget my name, my age. All of the problem is gone for 7.5 minutes. It's like meditation.
For a nation that eradicated its class system almost 100 years ago, we are strangely intrigued by the British class hierarchy. And most intrigued of all by your royal family.
Russians love royal family. As you know, we're unlucky not to have one. So they would definitely go to Buckingham Palace and change of guard. And, you know, so they love, they're very much aware of what's happening. So, you know, the other day, my mom called me and said, so Kate is pregnant. So, and I immediately knew who she was talking about. So I said, yes, yes, she's pregnant for the second child. So, mom, everything is fine.
Though Bolsheviks shot Tsar Nicholas and most of the Russian royal family in 1918, some did escape to Britain, and members of the Romanov clan are still alive and well.
My father was the eldest nephew of Nicholas II. Pa came out in 1919 with his father and his first wife. He came out from Odessa and got out on a British warship called HMS Forsyth. And they went to Paris to drum up support for the White Russian Army. Pa didn't talk to me enough about the past, and when I went back in 98 for the Tsar's funeral to see the places, you know, I had a feeling of home. It was extraordinary. It's in the genes. But I realised about the ancestors from a very young age, but because you're brought up with all that, and in my case being a princess, although when I was little I used to say to my mother, please don't call me princess, and when I was at finishing school, I made her write Miss Olga Romanov, which they thought was rather stupid. That is my mother, done by a Russian artist before she got married. Apparently London was awash with Russian princes between the wars. See? Yes, I know, and I know you've done something disagreeable. That's why you're all sort of humble. We'll find it shortly. Let's try not to walk in anything like the poor man did yesterday. Over there, there is a painting of my grandmother and her twin sister, my mother's mother, the Finns. Now, Russia ruled Finland in those days, and underneath they're in national costume, but actually not Finnish. It's part of Russia, though I can't remember what costume they're wearing, but it's not actually Finnish costume. But they were debutantes and presented at court in St. Petersburg to my great-great-grandfather, not knowing that one day the families would be united, which is quite strange. There is Queen Alexandra as a young girl. Over there is Alexander II with his attractive blue hair. Oh, I thought he needed a bit of a makeover. This is Irina, who is my father's elder sister. Irina, at the age of 18, married a man called Felix Yusupov. Now, Felix was one of the two that murdered Rasputin. But this is before he murdered Rasputin. He'd been in Oxford, and he batted both sides. He was very beautiful, but his best claim to fame was he was a transvestite. Anyway, they had a blissfully happy marriage, and when he was too old to do it himself, she'd put his makeup on for him. She used to smell of Gauloise and Chanel, and she was hilarious. She did wonderful caricatures for me when I was sort of sitting on my pot. Of course, my father jabbered away in Russian to all his family, but he never spoke Russian to me or my mother, so I'd never learned to speak Russian, which is quite sad. Apart from Russian blood, I haven't actually felt a strong link to the new Russians, but they are people I would very much like to meet, because I read about them all the time, like they maybe sometimes read about me, and it would be really nice to bridge the gap.
Three, balance, right, left.
Tonight, the gap will indeed be bridged, as Princess Olga has been invited as guest of honor to the ball. There are just 6 hours to go, and with the final rehearsal in full swing, the debutantes are beginning to look worthy of their name.
I am from Ukraine. We have Dan, who is coming first. He's also from Ukraine. So as you see, there are some political things happening around, of course. So whatever happened with politicians, we're still human beings. We still respect. We're still always glad to see each other and do something together.
Well, I'm very excited to be a debutante at the Russian Ball in London this year. And it's a good reason for my family to come and visit, because they're all still in Moscow and I live in London. I've been living here for the past 3 years.
Яблоко.
Yeah. Да, oh да. My god, I mean, звезда, I feel like a звезда. Real princess. I mean, even sandwiches.
When my mom was my age, she already had 2 children to take care of. So I really feel privileged that I can do things that I like and I can have relationships that I like.
Happy people, thank you.
I stopped comparing myself to my parents, because I understand that I'm already in a very, very different world, different place.
Tonight I've got to wear my princess face. It isn't really very regal, but you know, I have to put on a show and act.
The first ball is the time when she's first out, properly out, and ready to show off her beauty and probably to find a prince.
The closer we get to the ball, I actually get more and more excited. I can't wait.
Please stand on the final position for beginning of balls. Final 4 lines.
I'm looking for someone who is strong and reliable, someone who can look after you.
Whilst banker Katerina is looking for a romantic prince, Alyona and Katya debate gender roles over working lunch, a subject that inspires passionate discussion.
For me, understanding of what women is and what men is probably a little bit backwards. It's about women being at home and taking care of children, and the men being a brick wall. This is this Russian expression that no Englishman understand when we say, oh, we want the man that is like a brick wall. I was like, what do you mean? Why do you need a brick wall for?
Take it up very offensively. Are you calling me a brick wall?
Yeah, no, exactly. Yeah. I'm not calling you a brick wall.
It reminds me of when I was growing up in Soviet Union. We had these questions and all the boys were asked who you want to be.
Yeah.
And there, all the boys were answering cosmonaut.
Yeah, of course. Oh,
no.
Yeah.
I mean, and all the girls were asked who you want to be, and they would just say mother.
So we've got a lot of it in, I know my grandma was like this and is like this, and in schools. But when you come to England, what do you think?
I mean, I just think from my experience, because I've got a son, and you know, there are certain things that, you know, in English, in British schools, they put in children totally different things what we do, because in England they're teaching them how to be tolerant, they're opening horizons, and you know,
yeah.
And a lot of my clients sending their children here because education for Russians is, you know, extremely important, and you know, we're all competitive and they're all overachievers and hardworking people, and they would like their children to have different mentality from their kind of old Russian rigid kind of Soviet mentality, and they want them to become Western people and see the world through their own eyes. And in Britain, you have this chance.
I've always wanted a dog. Actually, I have a dog in Russia. It's a Chihuahua and Dachshund crossbreed. But now I really want another dog. So I was asking my mom for like 8 months, and then she said yes. And he's shaking because he's really cold now. Don't be scared.
Okay, let's go. Be careful.
Нормально? Как тебе мои волосы?
Go.
Как тебе мои волосы?
Очень хорошо. С другой стороны, садись.
Алена's client Natalia came to London largely to give her daughter Christina a top British education.
Tell me, how was your school today? What was your day?
It was really nice because I got 2 merits in chemistry, but then it was really bad.
2 merits?
Yeah, 2 merits.
Oh, my sister.
And also, but then I got 1 debit also, because in, like, we did this really cool experiment, and then I spilled these carbohydrate thing on someone's t-shirt, and then and it burned.
No way.
A little bit, like a little burn, and then it was really bad, and I nearly got a detention, but I know it's so bad, but yeah.
The most what I like in the English schools, that children don't afraid to make mistake. So, for example, Christy does her homework, yeah, herself, without my help, and she doesn't afraid.
She's not afraid.
She's not afraid. Thank you, darling. She's not afraid that it's wrong. She tries to do the best, you know. But in Russia, she really felt scared. Yeah.
Scared because the teachers were really strict.
Russian educational system has crumbled a little bit since Soviet Union times, and so everyone cares about their children. And London schools are considered to be the best in the world.
For Igor Tsukhanov, education is vital. He fully expects his son to go to Eton one day.
My little one is 2 years old. Oh, by the way, today his first time in a trip to Eton and to Windsor. Not first time. Yeah, 2 years. But I think, yeah, I really want to send him there because I really want to ensure that he's strong enough, smart enough, and trained enough. To go to Eton when he's there. So he has to be a part of that.
It's a matter of control. Let's do it again. From the passage, don't trust the passage.
So my daughter now, she's 12. She just started last year in Wickham Abbey. It's also the top private boarding school.
Again, and again.
And through this experience with my children, with my kids, so I learned a lot about how the system, how the British top schools, boarding schools, are run. And a part of education is not all about education, it's about how to convert young man or young girl into mature gentleman or mature lady. My first wish will be for my daughter Katya to be able to continue her music career to the level at which she will decide whether she wants to be a professional musician.
But it's not only his own children that Igor is supporting. Through his foundation, he offers scholarships and bursaries for gifted students to attend top schools in the UK and Russia.
I think that now there is a new generation of young people who were born in the 90s, and they're ambitious to learn, they're ambitious to do their own business, they're ambitious to challenge themselves. They go to very, very good universities, they work really hard, and the society is changing.
What's going to happen to parents in Russia when they realize that their children has set up so fully now integrated and living here? So most likely they'll move. So the wave of Russians that's currently has happened in the last 10, 15 years is going to continue, and a lot more prosperous, educated, intelligent Russians will move here. And that's not a bad thing. I think London's done really well.
In the city, the last touches are being applied before the Russian ball is finally underway.
This hasn't been out of its box for donkey's years.
Yeah.
And it's
Make sure that doesn't get nicked.
No, I will. I'll keep it with me all the time, at all times. It's my animal, my friend.
Yeah.
Mother bought this in 1960.
5 minutes.
Yeah. Yeah. Near the
door.
Do you think this is too much?
What your mum says.
Let me put this. Okay, I'm not eating anything else tonight.
And jump in the taxi and not be late. Because we have to start on time. As a dance partner, he has to leave, you know? So there was a bit of conflict there. As a woman, you can't take charge of everything.
This ball is taking place not in a very easy political period. And as you know, at the moment our countries have certain tensions, but particularly because of that, the importance of this ball is even more.
But while some Russians choose to celebrate, others have different priorities. Yevgeny is at a memorial for all those who have fallen victim to Russia's political regimes over the years.
Заведующий бюро иностранного опыта Всесоюзного НИИ пушного, мехового и охотно-промышленного хозяйства. Арестована 27 января 35 года. Расстреляна, реабилитирована в 68-м.
During the Soviet time, a lot of victims by regime, most of them the Communist Party members, and they was killed by their regime they created. We Russians killed more Russians than anybody else. That's the big, big problem, and a lot of dark history in our blood. a lot of things look similar now. Everybody who disagree and who is dangerous for regime, they try to push out of the country like me or put into the prison. And now, when you're reading the names, the big list of political victims who are still in the prison in Russia, I feel like my nation is damned by ourselves. Я честно, я не могу говорить сегодня. Я вообще не могу говорить.
Which side of yours is best?
I don't have a side.
Would you mind if I just got several photographs together with
yes,
you?
Yes, fine.
Oh,
of
thank you so
yes,
much. Yes, let's cheer yes. up.
Ladies, once more, this camera.
Yes.
Of course, yes. Sorry. Of course, yes.
If you'll be so kind. Thank you.
Ваши аплодисменты дебютантам. Второго русского бала в Лондоне. И сейчас я приглашаю всех гостей присоединиться к танцующим.
I was a debutante in 1968. Right. I think it must bring a lot of glamour to London and nice for the Russian debs to see what London's like.
For me, money is not that important. But I, of course, we need money to live on. But for me, it's not that important. For my mom, it's important, but for me, that.
Well, I mean, of course, they can buy you a very nice lifestyle and they can fix a few problems, but money can't buy you love.
We're happy to have money, yes. Can we hide it? No. Give us time, we'll be all right. We would stop to be all this bling bling and putting ourselves ahead of others, thinking of ourselves as better than others. We all do it, I don't know, English or Russian.
If you don't feel free, if your mind is not free, billions don't help you.
Near to the school, take the children. Once we've got the children in the van, then I can sit down and talk to the children and explain to them what's happening, what's going on. I know it's going to be very traumatic for them. I'm not only doing it for myself, I'm doing it for the children as well, because they have a right to know who their mother is.